In this tutorial, we're going to do hydrological modeling using SWAT, and we're going to use the QSWAT interface. We're going to focus on model building, and I will first of all go through what SWAT is quickly, how do you set up a SWAT model application, and how can you run and view the results of the model simulation. First of all, what is SWAT? SWAT is a spatially summary distributed time continuous hydrological model developed by the USDA in Texas. When you apply the model, you need GIS data, including DEM or topography, soil type, land use, and subcatchment ID. But the subcatchment ID can also be generated from the DEM if you don't have it. These layers are overlain and unique combinations are identified, and these unique combinations are referred to as hydrological response units, and in short you could say HRUs. It is at this scale that computations take place, and from each HRU flow is routed to the outlet of the subcatchment through a stream and later then to the watershed outlet. You also need weather data, including wind speed, temperature, relative humidity, solar radiation, and precipitation. Outputs include evapotranspiration, soil moisture, biomass, flow, and many more. SWAT has different interfaces that you can use. For instance, there is QSWAT for QGIS, ArcSWAT for ArcGIS. There is also an interface for map window, but as I pointed out earlier, we are going to use QSWAT for QGIS in this tutorial. It is important to check the data that you use for modeling. This helps you identify if you have enough data or enough quality to do the modeling exercise in the first place. To use the QSWAT interface, you need to install a total of 3 softwares: 1 QGIS, 2 QSWAT, and 3 SWAT editor. For QGIS, you specifically need a 32-bit version 2.6.1, and here's the link, but you don't have to type all this. You can just website here and you can download everything that you need from there. Let me show you how to do that. Here you have QSWAT 1.5. I'm sure there will be newer versions for SWAT, and you can download if you click this download link here. And you also get the compatible version of QGIS in the website. You just have to download that. And here you can also get the SWAT editor. All that you need, you're getting from this same website. All right. Once you have downloaded all that, then you need to install it. And only after then you can start the modeling process. Keep in mind that the tables that are present in the default database are made for the USA. So if you want to use this model in other parts of the world, you need to replace some of the tables present in the database. These are the user soil table and the weather generator table. You can find these tables as soon as the project is created, and only after then you can change the tables or replace them. I will show you how to do this in a while. Alright, now let's start building the model. We will create a model in this directory that we have already created here, and the dataset that we will use is the one that comes with the installation of your QSWAT. I will show you how to get it. You're going to see and then users, and you go to user profile, this will be your name, and then you go to .qgis2, and then you go into Python, and then you go into plugins and QSWAT, and then you will find the example data set there. I will open it and copy everything to the directory that we use. All right, so in the climate, we have a time series for precipitation, wind speed, solar radiation. You can check this. So this is the beginning date. And if you scroll down, you can see all the rainfall events. I'm closing it. And the same goes for the other weather parameters. And the file, like this one, links the stations. If you have more than one station, for instance, relative humidity, you have more lines there. And here is the DEM, it's from SRTM, and it's 30 meters resolution. So this is the file that we're going to select when we want to select the DEM from the QGIS interface. We have the land use also. So these maps have values that on their own, they don't have any meaning. And to identify which land use you're referring to, or which soil type that is, we use files known as lookup tables. So these are comma separated files, and this is an example. I'm going to open it with Notepad++. So it has soil ID, and that's the number on the map, and the soil name, that is the reference name in the soil database. So this is going to be your user soil. All right, so with this data, we're going to create our model, and I'm just going to create a new folder. Perhaps you have already noticed that I'm using shortcuts, and you can see down your screen the shortcuts that I'm using. So data, I'm going to put everything in this. Okay, so we are going to create our model in this folder, and to do that, we have to open QGIS first. And that's QGIS. Wait a second. Okay, now when you open QGIS, you will not have anything that will let you create a QSWAT project right away. You have to first of all add the plugin for QSWAT, and then you click plugins, manage plugins, and then you search for SWAT, and then you have to check this button. When you check it, it tells you that this is an experimental plugin. That's a warning, but don't worry, it works perfectly. Close. Now you should see the QSWAT or the SWAT button appearing, and you can click on it now to create a new project. So when you click it, you open the QSWAT interface now, and let me move it here. Now you click new project to create a new project. So this is where we want to save our project. I'm just going to give it a name, example project. Okay, save. Now we have created and saved our project. The model creation process takes place in three steps. And the first step is where you delineate the watershed and create all the sub-basins. And you create the HRUs as a second step. This is where you provide the land use and the soil map. And then lastly, you add the weather data to your model, and you can also edit other options such as routing methods. But before you begin, sometimes you have large rasters, and to speed up the process, you can install the Microsoft MPI and specify here where you have the binaries. This will speed up the processing of the rasters a lot. Here you specify the SWAT editor, so that when you click the edit input, the interface can find the SWAT editor installation at all. So step one, you delineate the watershed by clicking the delineate watershed, and then now you can load the DAM. At this stage, you should have already checked your data if it is okay for your modeling exercise. Now let's browse for the DAM. Okay, we click that button and then open the DEM. That's where you have the example data set, SRTM. And now you click the HDR.ADF. Choose that and then open. So after a few seconds, let's move this out of the way so that you can see what is actually in the background. Okay, now we see the topography of the area. The hillshed makes it nice. Here you have the number of cells, the threshold for creating the sub-basins in your catchment. You can have it in square kilometers, and you can even change the units if you want, but we are going to stick with square kilometers in this case. And this is the minimum area for which a sub-basin is going to be created, and you have the recommended values, but we're going to change that to 0.7. and now we can click create streams. Okay, sometimes you have a very flat land such that this process of flow direction and flow accumulation does not create the streams in accurate locations. What you do is you provide a stream network to assist with that process, and you have to choose this option and load the stream network. So in this case we have the stream network, not that we really need it due to the strong topography, but I recommend that you use it every time. So let's open it. Okay, now to create the streams, you wait, see the color is not so bright. Okay, but yeah, to apply it, you click on create streams, and then it does the pit filling and then flow direction and applies the threshold. Now we have our stream network. We can see that our provided stream for burning is matching the one, almost matching the one that has been generated from the DEM. That's good. Okay, so next you have to choose an outlet for your catchment. To do this, you can draw yourself the outlet if you know where it is, and depending on where you have the observations or gauge station data. But in our case, we have it, so we're going to browse like this. And then we select the main outlet shapefile. It has to have the SHP shapefile open. Okay, so we're going to select the inlet outlet. Okay, it's an outlet in this case. So when I select it, it's going to disappear this window. So you just have to bring it back after it disappears. Okay, now let's select, and then you can bring by alternate and tab. There you go. So save. Now it says one selected. So we have successfully selected our outlet. Now we're going to review snapped to see if our outlet is actually on a stream. It doesn't matter if it's not exactly on the stream, but if it is within the snap distance, which is in this case 300 meters, it's going to be brought near the stream. And okay, so review snapped. Yes, our point snapped to a stream. Now we can create the watershed by clicking on create watershed. All right, so now it applies the threshold again to the watershed. So the minimum area of the watershed should be the one that we specified. Now we have 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8 9 10 11 That's 11 subbasins created using this threshold. If we want, we can increase or decrease the number of subbasins depending on the level of the detail that we want our model to be. This is okay. If you stayed with the initial, I'm sure you would have ended up with the same number of subbasins. All right, now you might also be annoyed with some subbasins which are small and you want to have to merge them. So to do that, you can use the merge section here. You just have to select the subbasins and click merge, and let's merge these ones because this is small. So let's merge. So select subbasins. So you have this, control that, and then switch, save, and merge. There you go. So now you have these two subbasins merged with the smaller one because it's downstream. Okay. If you have any reservoir that is in your subcatchment or in your catchment, you can add using that, but we don't have that in our modeling area, so we're just going to skip that and go ahead and say okay. So at this point, we are ready to proceed to the next stage, step 2, where we are going to create the HRUs. Now, as I said earlier, you're overlaying different maps, and these maps have lookup tables that identify what each value represents in the SWAT database. And we have the tables necessary for all these lookups. So we're going to have to import those to our reference database. And let's do that. I'm going to show you how to do that. In our folder here, we have the project, the QGIS project file, and then we have the directory where everything about the project is stored. It has the same name as the project file. So in this here, you have the QSWAT reference database from 2012. That's a 2012 version of SWAT. And you open that, and then you see different tables on the left here. The tables that we want to replace or we want to add, you can find them here, user. So it's the user soil and the weather generator. We don't have to specifically replace them, but for user soil, I'm going to use the same name here. So I'm going to rename the original one to old so that I can import one and name it user soil. I don't have to change this. I could if I want, but I don't want to. So let's import it. We're going to import from Microsoft Excel. All right, so browse and go where we have our dataset. So this is where we have our user soil, and then this is the weather generator. So user soil, import that first. Okay, this is true. The first row contains column headings. All right, proceed. That's okay. Let me choose my own primary key. Okay. All right, so we're going to use this name, user soil, finish. And then you will have user soil appearing here. So this was the old one, and then this is the new one. We're also going to import WGEN, and it's the same process. Let's do it. Browse and select. I just double clicked it, and now okay, so this is it. It's just one record. And next, the first row contains column headings. That's true. Yes. And let me choose my own primary key. And Next. If you want, you can put user here to replace this one, but I'm just going to leave it like that. Fine. Close. Now I have WGN, I can check it. WGN Robert. Okay. That's fine. At this stage, we can proceed with our HRU creation. So I click on HRU create HRUs. Wait, let me just bring this up. Okay. I click on create HRUs button. Create HRUs. And the first thing that I have to provide is the land use map. And this is here, land use map. Go inside and select the hdr.adf file. You do the same with the soil map. So I go to, okay. Let's see here, data, and then soil, hdr.adf, open. Okay, so we have to provide the lookup tables, as I said, to relate the values on the map and the values in the database, or the text in the database, actually. We have different layers. We have the topography map. The topography is used to generate a slope map, and then this is based on the values or the classes that we enter here. Or by default, you have one slope class, 0% to the maximum slope. Now we can add others like 5%. So we have two classes now, 0 to 5, and 5 to the maximum slope. We could also add another one, let's say 15%. If you make a mistake or you want to change, you can click on clear and then do it again. All right. So we just have two slope classes, 0 to 10 and 10 to the maximum slope class. In case you want to see the HRU for mapping your results, then you should click on generate the full HRU shapefile. If not, you can leave it out. That's okay. In this case, we're going to select it. And then now we are ready to read the maps. And when we click read at maps, we're going to provide the lookup files in form of CSVs. All right. Now we go back to the data area, and it says here choose lookup land use lookup CSV file. So I choose the land use lookup file just to show you how it looks. Okay. So land use and how it is identified in the SWAT database. So 1, 2, 3, 4 for water, agriculture, pasture, and forest. All right. So you select that. And then now it says choose soil lookup CSV file. This is the soils. Don't select the user soil. It's the same as the one that we imported. This is the lookup file for the soils. Okay. So open that. And it will read the maps. You just have to wait. All right. So now we have our full HRUs and we have read the maps in memory. The next thing that we want to do is to filter these HRUs. So there are some who want a simple model where you have one or single HRU per sub-basin, or maybe you want multiple HRUs per sub-basin. So depending on your need or the level of complexity, you can choose the dominant land use or dominant soil or dominant slope. This option will choose the HRU with the dominant either of these, and you have one HRU per sub-basin.
It's also the same, the HRU that is dominant in the sub-basin is the one that is going to be used to represent the whole sub-basin. And you can also filter to have more HRUs in an area, in a sub-basin by use of percentages. So this is percent of the sub-basin. If an HRU is more than 9% of the sub-basin in land use, and more than let's say 5% here, based on what we have done, go. And if it is, let's say it's 8%, and we have HRUs, if HRU has area less than this, then they will be filtered out. But we'll have multiple HRUs per sub-basin. Now, you can also go with filter by area, or you can target the number of HRUs and just enter that number. And you can also, the threshold methods, where you specify the thresholds instead of percentage, you can specify in terms of area. But for now, we have a total number of 51 HRUs and filtered, and after this, it's probably going to reduce. Now, there is a button that is hiding down there. You just have to extend this. Okay. Create HRUs. Right? Okay. So the number of HRUs has reduced to 26 from a total of 51. You can view all these things in the reports, HRU report, a total of 26 HRUs. Okay. Cross. There are a bunch of other reports here that you might be interested in. So the third step is to edit inputs and run SWAT. But I'm going to stop the tutorial here for now.